The iconic audio format of the 1970s was the 8-track tape. It was never known for the best audio quality, and especially not known for the best reliability, but nonetheless it was an inexpensive and convenient way to play music. Sales of 8-track tapes peaked in 1978, when over 133 million of these things were sold in the US. But after then, 8-tracks fell out of favor as quickly as disco and bell-bottom jeans did. And by 1980, sales were eclipsed by the cassette tape, which had been increasing in popularity all through the 1970s, and by the 1980s, it was king, and 8-tracks were relegated to the dustbin of history. Nonetheless, from around the mid-1970s to the early 1980s, many people did have and wanted to be able to play both formats. And to fulfill that need, there were stereo components available which supported both cassette tapes and 8-track tapes. But due to the physical differences between the two formats, that always required two separate mechanisms, one for cassette tapes and a separate one for 8-track tapes. After all, they're completely different sizes, they run at different speeds, they use different widths of tape and different track layouts, and most importantly, one is a miniature reel-to-reel format in a cassette shell, and the other one is an endless loop cartridge format. So it was impossible to make a one-size-fits-all device which could accept both formats. But apparently, Soundesign didn't get the memo, because this may look like one of their cheap 1970s stereo systems with an FM radio tuner, an AM radio tuner, and an 8-track player. But if we take a closer look at the front panel, it clearly says cassette-8-track, and again down here, AM-FM stereo receiver, cassette 8-track player. So apparently they were able to engineer a device which could play 8-tracks and cassettes in the same slot. The question is, how? But before we ponder that mystery, let's take a quick look at its other features. As I mentioned, it has an AM-FM radio tuner. Get me running, and you know I'll be around. That's actually AM, which sounds surprisingly good. Now I'll switch over to FM. And it has a lighted tuning dial, including a stereo indicator that lights up when I tune in a station broadcasting in stereo. And that's playing through these Soundesign speakers. These may not be the exact model that it originally came with, because I acquired these separately, but they do match the styling. And these actually do have real tweeters, unlike most Soundesign speakers. They have 8-inch woofers and 3-inch tweeters, and on the back it claims a maximum power handling of 15 watts RMS. And I love how they have this graph on the front showing the frequency response of the speakers from 20 Hz to 15 kHz. On the back of the stereo system, we can see its Soundesign model 4645B as connections for an FM antenna, an input for either a turntable of a ceramic phono cartridge or a line level input, a tape output, and also outputs for main and auxiliary speakers. And it's UL listed and was made in Japan. For a Soundesign, I'm impressed with the build quality of this stereo system. For example, it has a pretty sturdy plywood cabinet, not cheap particle board, and on the bottom is a sticker with the circuit diagram and a date code of August 1976. And here it is featured in the 1976 Blue Book of Quality Merchandise. It had a price of $125. And thank you to Grace Robbins for scanning this in for me. You already saw it playing an 8-track tape earlier, but here's the moment you've all been waiting for. Will it play a cassette tape as advertised? And the answer is yes, it absolutely will.
Yeah.
There is no rewind, but we do get a fast forward. And the button that changes the program when you're listening to an 8-track doubles as an eject button for the cassette. 7.3. It also auto-ejects when it reaches the end of the cassette. In a moment, we're going to open this thing up and discover the inner workings of this miraculous device, but just by listening to it, I can already tell it shares some parts in common between the 8-track player and the cassette player. For example, when I put in an 8-track, you can hear that rather noisy motor, and also the noisy solenoid that changes the program. It's currently on program 3. Pull out the 8-track, put it in a cassette. Hear that same motor? Sounds the same. Now push the button to eject the cassette. And it sounds like that same solenoid that changes the programs on the 8-track. And indeed it is, because if I now put in the 8-track, we're on program 4. So ejecting the cassette actually changed the program of the 8-track player. At this point, you may have realized that I've only taken it apart after I've already demonstrated it. That's because this thing did not require any repairs. The only thing I've done so far is spray some contact cleaner into the controls because the volume control is a little bit scratchy, and now that is fixed. And from the top, the tape player looks like an ordinary 8-track player. You can see the motor, the head, the capstan, and the solenoid, which changes the program when you push the button. Here it is at program 1, program 2, program 3, program 4, then back to program 1. And here's Mr. Sparky, the sensor which automatically changes the program when it detects the metal foil on the tape. So when I put it in a cartridge, that all looks completely normal for an 8-track player. But if you look way down inside there, you can just about see the head for playing cassettes. So I'll put in a cassette and you'll see what happens. Now I'll push the button to eject the cassette. Unfortunately, I can't find any indication of who manufactured this mechanism. The only thing on it is this sticker on the bottom saying it was made in Japan under license agreement of Star SA, Brussels, Belgium. I looked that up, and in 1970, they were granted a patent for what they called a shiftable drive carriage cassette tape loading system. And I think this is what they're referring to. Normally this stays out of the way so you can stick in an 8-track and it won't be obstructed. But when you put in a cassette, this swings up to provide the mechanism for playing it. I propped open the door and you can see way in the back is the head and capstan for playing 8-tracks. But if I swing up that mechanism, there's the mechanism for playing cassettes, which swings up when needed and drops back down when it's not needed. You can see it has a fixed post because it does not rewind, so it only needs the forward direction spindle. And then you can see the head and capstan and pinch roller. Looking at it from the side, you can kind of see how this is essentially two mechanisms sandwiched together. On the top is the 8-track player mechanism, and down here is a cassette player mechanism that swings up when needed for playing cassettes and then pops back down when you eject it. Here I'll put in the cassette again. And here's the fast forward button. I don't know why they needed such a big heavy metal mechanism just to fast forward. You can see it has two springs on it. That's really quite elaborate. And when I let go, it starts playing again. and I'll push the button to eject the cassette. Here's the view from underneath when playing an 8-track. And now when playing a cassette. It uses the same motor and flywheel as for playing 8-tracks, but then there's this idler wheel here, which transfers power to this other flywheel, which drives the cassette mechanism. And you may have noticed that the idler is actually changing the direction of the rotation when playing a cassette, because if I align the cassette the way it's put into the machine, the reels are going to be turning counterclockwise. So if I carefully open this 8-track, the reel is going to be rotating clockwise and falling apart in the process. Here's a better look at it. I'll hold it so it doesn't come unspooled this time. The 8-track rotates clockwise, while the cassette tape rotates counterclockwise. You also have to keep in mind that an 8-track runs twice as fast as a cassette. 8-tracks play at 3 3/4 inches per second. Cassettes play at 1 7/8 inches per second. So that idler wheel actually does double duty and not only changes the direction of the rotation for 8-tracks and cassettes, it also changes the speed. Looking at the circuit diagram on the bottom, we can see the 8-track head and the cassette head, and there's the switch to go between them. So the only thing that's actually switched electronically is which head is connected to the rest of the circuitry. All the amplification and equalization, everything else for playing a tape is exactly the same regardless if it's a cassette or an 8-track. Only the heads are switched. So electronically there's almost no difference between playing cassettes and 8-tracks, but obviously mechanically there's a whole lot more going on here than it would be for just an 8-track only player or a cassette only player. It's a shame this multi-format cassette and 8-track player didn't catch on, because imagine if it would have inspired someone to create a VCR which can play both VHS and beta. You may think that's impossible, but you probably thought what this thing does is impossible too. But I can think of several reasons why this multi-format player design didn't become popular. One is that they actually did too good of a job of making it look indistinguishable from a normal 8-track player. So if someone was looking for a stereo system which could play both cassettes and 8-tracks and they saw this on the shelf, they would think it's just a normal 8-track only player and they would pass it by. Plus, I think it was out of step with what the average consumer was looking for back in 1976 when this was introduced, because back then the 8-track was still the dominant music listening format, and cassettes were most popular for recording, which is something this cannot do because it's just a player, not a recorder. And even if it could record, it wouldn't be able to do what many people wanted, and that is to copy their 8-tracks to cassettes, because it can only accept one at a time, not both. Nonetheless, I enjoy taking a look at products which tried to innovate new features and actually work remarkably well, but just didn't succeed in the marketplace and catch on, including both this combined cassette and 8-track player from Soundesign in 1976, and also this MP-ROM MP3 CD player from 1999, which also works perfectly fine playing through the aux input of this stereo system.